Good morning. And good morning to all of you gathered at home as well. Welcome to worship on the second Sunday of Easter. The second Sunday of Easter is sometimes affectionately referred to as Low Sunday because it often is one of the lowest attended Sundays of the year. But I have no idea how many of you are watching at home, but we are gathered together in person and in spirit on this day where we continue the joy of our Lord's resurrection for 50 days, a week of weeks. And today we hear the story of Thomas, unfortunately known as Doubting Thomas throughout all of history, although he was one of the faithful disciples. We'll hear his story today, and we begin our worship by remembering that even in this season of joy, we are in need of God's mercy and forgiveness. And so I invite you to rise in body or spirit as we begin our worship with our confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the fountain of living water, the rock who gave us birth, our light and our salvation. Amen. Amen. Rejoicing in Christ's victory over sin and death, let us come before God, who calls us to repentance. Faithful and just God, we confess that we are captive to doubt and fear, bound by the ways that lead to death. We have not loved one another as you have loved us. Forgive us, God of mercy. Let your Holy Spirit work in us to change our lives and make us new, that we may know the abundant life given in Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Amen. In this is love. Not that we loved God, but that God loved us and sent the Son to atone for our sins. In the name of Jesus Christ, I announce to you that your sins are forgiven. Let the perfect love of God cast out fear, fill you with joy, and inspire you to live for others. Amen. Alleluia, Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed, alleluia. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia.
Let us pray. Mighty God, in whom we know the power of redemption, you stand among us in the shadows of our time. As we move through every sorrow and trial of this life, uphold us with the knowledge of the final morning, when in the glorious presence of your risen Son, we will share in his redemption, redeemed and restored to the fullness of life, and forever freed to be your people. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated.
A reading from Acts. Now the whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one claimed private ownership of any possessions, but everything they owned was held in common. With great power the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as owned lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
To all your people.
A reading from 1 John. We declare to you what was from the beginning, what we have heard, what we have seen with our eyes, what we have looked at and touched with our hands concerning the word of life. This life was revealed, and we have seen it and testified to it, and declare to you the eternal life that was with the Father and was revealed to us. We declare to you what we have seen and heard, so that you also may have fellowship with us. And truly our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. We are writing these things so that our joy may be complete. This is the message we have heard from him and proclaim to you, that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him while we are walking in darkness, we lie and do not do what is true. But if we walk in the light, as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he who is faithful and just will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. My children, I am writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. The word of the Lord.
Blessed are those who have not seen, and yet have come to believe. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. The Holy Gospel according to John. Glory to you, O Lord. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked because they were afraid, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails in my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated, and I invite the children who are watching virtually to come close around the TV or the iPad, wherever you are. We can have a word together. Good morning. So Jesus said three times to his disciples today words that are probably very familiar to you because we say them every time we gather together in church. Do you know what those four words are? Peace be with you. Those are very special and very important words. Peace be with you is not, I know when we say it in church, we often go around and greet each other, but it's way more than just saying, hi, how are you doing, or good morning, or it's good to see you. Although it can mean all of those things too. Peace be with you is Jesus' special way of saying, do not be afraid. I am alive and I am here for you. When we say peace be with you, we are reassuring each other of that. We are reminding each other that Jesus is risen and that just as he came into that locked room with all of those scared people, he is here in our midst. He is with you wherever you are today. And he wishes you peace. Peace is way more than just not having anything bad going on. Peace is knowing deep in your heart that you are loved and that you are cared for and that you are safe. And that's what Jesus means when he says, peace be with you. It's as if, and when we wish it to each other, we are saying, I wish the very best for you. I care for you. I love you. Whatever is between us is gone. I forgive you, and I want to be in relationship with you. That's why we say those words before we come to the Lord's table, so that we can come and share communion as one body, all forgiven and reconciled with each other. So I'm going to wish you peace this morning. Peace be with you. And know that it means all of that. Yes, it means good morning, good to see you, but it means that you are loved and safe and forgiven because Jesus Christ is risen. Let us give God thanks for that gift. Lord Jesus, you are always showing up where people are afraid and wishing them peace. Thank you for being wherever we are today, for coming through whatever walls separate us, and breathing upon us your love and forgiveness. Bless our children wherever they may be this morning, and give us all your perfect peace. Amen. Thank you.
It's amazing how quickly our habits can change. How something that a year ago felt awkward and uncomfortable has become so commonplace now that it almost feels normal, even though it's definitely not normal. I don't know if you've had this experience, but there have been several times this past year, particularly at the height of the pandemic, when I was watching a movie or a television show where a lot of people were gathered close together, indoors, without masks, maybe within inches of each other's faces, and me saying out loud, "That's not safe! What are you people doing? You're breathing all over each other." It's almost hard to imagine that we used to do those things, things that for all of human history, people have been doing, and we will someday do again. But right now, our collective consciousness is so attuned to the pandemic that we look at these ordinary actions in different ways. I used to look at the scene in our gospel today where Jesus breathes on the disciples and invites Thomas to touch him as this beautiful, intimate encounter. Breath, after all, is what gives life. The word for spirit in Hebrew, ruach, literally means breath of God. The ancient poetry of the Old Testament says that God breathed the breath of life into us at creation, and then Jesus, by his breath, recreates us, fills us with his life, his power, his love. But we've just spent a whole year avoiding other people's breath at all costs. Breath and the watery particles it carries have become synonymous with danger, with contagion, something we must go to great lengths to avoid to stop the spread of the virus. We wear masks, we open windows and doors, we use air purifiers, we physically distance, and God forbid we touch. And if we do accidentally, we pull out the hand sanitizer really quick. Now, don't get me wrong. These things are all necessary and good. They are what love of neighbor looks like right now. But for people like us who believe in an incarnate God, who practice an embodied sacramental faith, a faith which requires human bodies and all that that entails, it has been disruptive, to say the least. But it also causes us to look at stories like this one in a different light, maybe even opening them up in a new way. Because while my first reaction to imagining Jesus breathing upon his disciples and inviting them to touch him this year is to recoil a bit, the more I think about it, the more I wonder if it doesn't capture the magnitude of what Jesus is really doing. The disciples are all huddled in this room on the evening of the first Easter because they are deathly afraid. They saw what happened to Jesus, how the mob had turned on him, how no one protected him, and they were worried that they were next. And as we saw with Peter, ordinary people recognized these guys. They were not some anonymous figures. They were publicly associated with Jesus as his closest followers. And into this locked room comes Jesus. Now, we've all been in that room before, the room where we are closed off to the world, closed off to love, paralyzed and boxed in by fear, whether it be something in particular or just the fear of the unknown. And I don't mean staying home because of the pandemic. I mean when we go to that place where we cannot experience joy anymore, when we are suspicious of everyone and everything, when we are held in the grip of old grievances and wrongs. It doesn't have to be a literal room that we lock ourselves in fear. It can be a prison made of lies, of prejudices, of unhealed pain from the past, or even a rift between two people. Into that place, the risen Christ appears and says, "Peace be with you." Never mind that no one lets him in. If death cannot hold him, certainly the walls and doors that we erect won't hold him either. But then comes that gesture, the breath, the touch, and the words which remain as stunning today as I'm sure they were then. Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained. The thing that Jesus breathes onto them is not just forgiveness for themselves. It is also the power to forgive others, to continue Jesus' ministry in the world, to share it with others, to spread it almost like it's contagious. It's as if this new life that Jesus now lives, this life beyond all sin and death and fear, cannot be kept to himself. It passes along very easily to every person Jesus encounters. Just being in the same room with him, breathing the same air, touching his body, and you have it, and then you give it to others. As the Father has sent me, so I send you, he says. And of course, this thing we are receiving and giving is not like the virus, which causes harm and death, but rather something that gives freedom and life. But it works in a surprisingly similar way when you think about it. When love and forgiveness is unleashed upon a population, when mercy spreads faster than judgment and retribution, when those who have encountered the peace of the risen Jesus go out and extend it to others, it always affects more than just a handful of people. It is, if you will, a pandemic of grace. It changes everything, our pattern of life, our ways of relating to each other, our care for the creation, the way we use our time and resources. It is all transformed forever in Christ's resurrection from the dead. For those first apostles, it looked like a total reorientation of society. They were of one heart and soul, it said. They held their possessions in common, and there was not a needy person among them. And other people noticed. How could anyone live this way? They must have experienced something that changed their outlook, their values, that made them different people. And look at your own lives, beloved. We all come here because we need something. We need to see and to touch like Thomas, to hear those words of blessing spoken over our lives. We need to know that forgiveness and healing for ourselves. We need to taste and see that the Lord is good. But then we get sent out. Every single gathering we have in this space ends with the words, "Go in peace." Take what you have received here and then share it with others, whether it be by your words, your actions, or your very presence. Let others know by your life that Christ is risen. And that isn't so the church can have more members. It's so the world can be transformed more and more into that beloved community, what Jesus called the kingdom of God. It's so that same Holy Spirit, that same breath of God which Jesus breathes upon the church, can permeate all of society, the fruits of which are love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There are perhaps a million variants, and the way they take root in a person's life is always different. But there's no going back to a pre-resurrection world. Christ is alive, and he meets us once again this morning, wherever we are. And when he gives himself to us, we become what we receive. We are the body of Christ. The resurrected life of Jesus is infectious, beloved. But not everything that is infectious is bad. In this case, the breath of God, which awakened the universe from nothing, which gave life to all creation, and which raised Jesus from the dead, is now breathed into us, filling us with his spirit, his essence, his life. Our bodies, tired and wounded as they are revived by his risen body, his blood flowing through our veins like a life-giving transfusion of grace. And now it is no longer we who live, but Christ who lives in us. That life is ours forever. And while it does not make us immune to suffering or death, it does take away its fear. It does break down the walls that hold us captive. And it shines forth from us, redeeming the world as it always does through human flesh and blood. Amen.
Said Jesus, love our risen
live as once I died to save. Feed the hungry, clothe the naked, visit ones in need of care. Give the homeless warmth and shelter, Christ will find a welcome there. See my hands and feet, said Jesus, love arisen from the grave. Be my hands and feet, said Jesus, live as once I died to save. And serve without distinction all earth's people, first and least. Know within each act of kindness, hope and wholeness are increased. See my hands and feet, said Jesus, love arisen from thy grave. Be my hands and live as once I died to save. Hands that beckon little children, bind a wound, prepare a meal. Feet that rush to share good tidings, Christ arisen still reveal. See my hands and feet, said Jesus, love arisen from the grave. Be my hands and feet, said Jesus, live as once I died to save.
With the whole church, let us confess our faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
On the second Sunday of Easter, let us pray for all in any need, responding to each petition with the words, "Send us your peace, O God." O faithful God, grant the joy of your peace to our pastors, to all those who minister among us, and to all the baptized, especially during times of hardship. Help us to support one another's churches, to cease rivalries, and to strengthen our ecumenical contacts. Hear our prayers for the church. Send us your peace, O God. Grant the beauty of your peace to all of nature, its springtime flowers, its wildlife, its terrains. Restore waters, cleanse the air, and save lands that have been misused. Inspire us to care for the whole of your creation. Hear our prayers for the earth.
Send us your peace, O God.
Grant the power of your peace to the nations of the world. Halt all impulses towards violence between nations in our city streets and inside our homes. Lead our government into wise decisions concerning migrants, especially the youths. Bring an end to ethnic prejudices in our land and guide judges and juries to enact justice throughout each court proceeding. Hear our prayers for this country.
Send us your peace, O God.
Grant the abundance of your peace to all agencies of care in church and government. Show us the best ways to uphold and support those in need. Inspire children to share. Open our hearts to a world so filled with suffering, and make us always more generous with the gifts you have given us. Hear our prayers for a world of goodwill.
Send us your peace, O God.
Grant the well-being of your peace to all who suffer. Visit all who are ill, especially those suffering from COVID-19, those without access to the vaccines, and those with strained medical resources. Comfort with your merciful presence those who are distanced from family and friends, and all who are lonely or distressed. Hear our prayers for the sick.
Send us your peace, O God.
We praise you for embracing your people with the wounded arms of Christ, and we bless you for all who died in the faith. At the end of all things, bring us with them into your everlasting peace. Hear our prayers for life beyond our understanding. Send us your peace, O God. In praise for the new life you grant us in Christ, we raise our prayers to you, trusting in your never-ending goodness and mercy. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen. May the peace of the risen Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us share a sign of peace with each other. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. Peace be with you.
God of love, you call us beloved children and welcome us to your table. Receive our lives and the gifts we offer. Abide with us and send us in service to a suffering world for the sake of your beloved child, Jesus Christ.
Amen. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also
lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, for the glorious resurrection of our Savior, Jesus Christ, the true Paschal Lamb who gave himself to take away our sin, who in dying has destroyed death, and in rising has brought us to eternal life. And so with Mary Magdalene and Peter, and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, and with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy. our weakness, in all our doubt, we turn to you, God of the ages, for you alone can make us whole. You have never stopped loving us, you have never forsaken us, and you never will. You take what is broken and through your death break it of its power. What once was hurt, what once was friction, what once left a mark no longer stings, because your grace makes beauty out of ugly things, and the life which is your love for us never ends. Send your Holy Spirit upon us, and on this bread and wine we share, the produce of the earth and the fruit of human labor, that they would become for us the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. In them you have promised to be present. Through them you can make us whole. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Together as the body of Christ, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died, Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
As we lift this bread and cup, we lift all the pain and pleasure of this world, all the prayers and people we carry in our hearts, and we unite them with the sacrifice of Jesus. We hang our lives on your mercy, Lord God, and we wait for your coming in glory, when all that is broken will be made whole, all that is lost will be restored, and all that is dying will live through him, who by sharing in our humanity brought us at last to God.
Through him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Hallelujah. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast.
Hallelujah.
To receive communion today, I invite you to come forward by household and to receive the bread from me at the foot of the altar, the steps there, and then from Brianne to take from the chalice, the tray, either the red wine or the white grape juice. And if you would, place your cup into that gray container at the end of the pew on your way back to your seat. This is God's table, and all are welcome here. Please rise.
Wellspring of joy, through this meal you have put gladness in our hearts. Satisfy the hunger still around us and send us as joyful witnesses that your love may bring joy to the hearts of all people. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Amen. May our glorious God grant you a spirit of wisdom to know and to love the risen Lord Jesus. And the God of life, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen. Amen. Welcome once again to worship this morning, those of you gathered in this space and in all the places where we are gathered today. You are invited to join us at 11:45 for our online time of fellowship on Zoom. The link is in your bulletin and in the email. And God be with you until we meet again.
Alleluia, Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed, alleluia.
You are the body of Christ, raised up for the world. Go in peace and share the good news.
Thanks be to God.